Well, good morning, fellow Toastmasters. How is everyone doing today?
Good morning.
I see we all got our coffee in our systems and everything else.
Well, that's a work in progress.
It truly is. Before we get started with the meeting, please everyone silence your cell phones. Yep. Now I would like everyone to please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. Our club mission is to provide a supportive learning experience in which members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. Looking forward to a great toast. Is this the meeting where we will have our guest speaker today?
Next week.
Okay, I'm definitely looking forward to that one. We have ourselves a great lineup. And with that said, I would like to go ahead and welcome up our Toastmaster for the evening. Oh, there we go. Oh, what the Toastmaster was. Evening, yes. This is what happens when you're a server.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes.
Is everybody awake, as he said, with coffee and everything?
Not yet.
Well, I'm occasionally Toastmaster, and I like to pick a theme that is just whatever's going on in my life. The last time was quite a while ago, but I went to New Orleans, and this time we happened to be doing a puzzle Sunday morning, and as a family, and I thought, just curious what everybody does for family time when they get together either with their parents or their kids. So that's what the theme of the day will be. That before we get into the meeting too much, let's figure out there are a few adjustments on the agenda. As a grammarian, we have a guest member, Andy Murphy, is that right? And the word of the day is what's up here. We'll go over that, not what's on the agenda.
Encourage.
For the table topics, it will be Eugene. And the evaluators is just getting figured out as we come in, but it looks like it will be Carrie. And Rich will be taking over for Jorge. I think that's all.
Where's my evaluator?
So, Rich.
Rich, Massa. Book.
Let's see. Yeah.
You can't stop playing with my emotions here.
Toastmaster family. So one of the other things we do along with puzzles is a Rubik's Cube. So I put a couple of these around. If anybody knows how to solve it, go ahead. My technique when I was little was to take it apart. I've heard other people take the stickers off. I never got to that point. But now my new technique is I downloaded the instructions off the internet, and it's actually tough to follow the instructions and solve it. So I'm trying to teach my kids how to follow the instructions, but at least you don't have to take it apart to solve it. And works pretty well. Along with puzzles, we also like to go on runs and bike rides together as a family. I went to parents.com to see what their ideas for family time were, and the funny thing was I started reading and it started talking about cooking and doing laundry, and then I realized it was saying how to make time for family time, but to me those were ideas for things. I wouldn't mind. I'll get my kids to do laundry with me and I'll consider that family time too. So.
Clean your room.
Yeah, we'll clean their room. No, we don't do that. Nobody does that. So let's go on to check in with the technical table this morning. First, we'll check in with our grammarian, Andy Murphy.
Good
As grammarian, it is my function to select a word of the day, but some kind soul has already taken care of that for me. And so the word of the day is encourage. As a definition, to give support, confidence, or hope to someone. Now, the word of the day is to help build members' vocabularies. Each member, when called upon to speak, is encouraged. Okay, yeah, okay, this, over here we wrap at this club on the word of the day, great. Encouraged to use the word of the day. Other members may gently rap on the table when they hear the use of the word. In addition, I will be listening for any errors in grammar, as well as excellent word selections. I'll also be noting any colorful thoughts or phrases any member might use. During the evaluation portion of the meeting, I will present my report. Thank you.
And now we'll go to our timer, Ernst.
My function is to time the speakers, evaluators, and table topic participants to ensure they meet the timing requirements. I will demonstrate the timing lights, i.e. cards, which will be displayed as follows. I encourage you to speak the minimum of 5 minutes as a speaker, 1 minute table topic, or 2 minutes as evaluator. For speaker, green will be raised at 5 minutes, yellow at 6 minutes, and red at 7. You will be disqualified at 7.5 minutes. Stand outside the door. Table topics, 30 seconds, you will get green, yellow at 45 seconds, and red at 1 minute. After 1.5 minutes, you will be disqualified. Evaluators, green at 2 minutes, yellow at 2.5 minutes, and red at 3 minutes. Mr. Toastmaster, this is my report.
And I forgot to mention one other adjustment. The first two are 5 to 7, but Alexandra's, oops, she's telling her right now. His is actually, hers is actually 2 to 3. Huh?
Oh. 1 to 3.
1 to 3 is what she wants.
1 to 3.
Alexandra is doing 1 to 3 minutes instead of 6 to 8 minutes. From an interpretive reading.
It's the shortest
bit.
Well,
your face.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. And now we'll check in with our awe counter, Julia Kaufman.
As your awe counter, it is my responsibility to catch all those filler words, and I encourage you not to use the ahs, the ums, the sos, the u-likes, because you will incur an infraction of 5 cents for each one, and you'll have to ante up to our treasurer right here. At the end of the meeting, I will let you know what you owe. Thank you.
I hope our treasurer accepts plastic. Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna go straight into our first speaker. This month marks 10 years since our next speaker first arrived to the City Beautiful. Speaking from the Competent Communication Manual number 6, please welcome Macarena Torres.
Raise your hand if you were born or raised in Orlando.
Oh. What?
No, it's okay. Every time I ask this question or I hear this question being asked, not very many people raise their hands. Why? Because Orlando is a very transient city. I myself was not born in Orlando, nor was I born in Florida, for that matter. But I moved to Orlando to attend the University of Central Florida as a freshman in 2005, which was 10 years ago. That's a decade ago. So I'd like to take this time to celebrate my 10-year anniversary with you lovely folks. Before moving to the city beautiful, the one word that popped into my head when I thought about Orlando was what? Disney! Disney World, the theme park. So that's all I thought about when I thought about the word Orlando. Disney isn't even in Orlando, by the way. It's in Lake Buena Vista. After all, theme parks are the one place that out-of-towners go to when visiting Orlando. That's the only place they care about going to. They never travel outside of Orlando. But after moving to Orlando and becoming a local, I began to realize all the hidden treasures that are located in the neighborhoods of Orlando. There's tons and tons of things to do. You just have to find it and discover it. Discover it with other people. Most of it, I ran into it by accident. For example, who's been to Winter Park? The majority. Winter Park has a lot to offer. There's Park Avenue, great for strolls in the park. You can take your dog. There's tons of little boutiques and shops, most of which I can't afford. But it's a great place to go eat, have brunch. Sometimes they have festivals. There's the Winter Park Art Festival in the spring and in the fall. It has a great nightlife. There's tons to do. There's restaurants you can go visit. If you love to paddleboard, there's a lake right behind Rollins College where they can teach you how to paddleboard. And I did it. It was amazing. It was fun. If you've been to Crane's Roost in Altamont Springs, they have tons of festivals there. The festival coming up is the Latin Food and Wine Festival. That's coming up pretty shortly, and I will be attending that because I love attending festivals. There's tons of people that go, so it can get a little bit crowded, but it's something to do. If you are looking for something to do during the nighttime, there's tons of things to do also. You can go to downtown Orlando. There they have the brand spanking new Dr. Phillips Center. If you love musicals like I do, you can check out a musical there or music. There's orchestras and performing arts there that there's something going on every month. There's also the local food in Orlando is amazing. I've discovered plenty and diverse, different little cafes and restaurants. If you're a local of College Park area, I would recommend you check out Trevi Pasta. If you love pasta, this place, shut up. We actually stumbled upon it through Yelp. We were in the area, we were trying to find something to do. We discovered it through Yelp. And it's a little tiny restaurant. You wouldn't think anything of it, but the locals there are straight from Italy. And they make fresh, fresh pasta. You can see the pasta being made in their pasta machines. And you have to get there early because they will run out of what's on the menu. There are times I want to try their squid pasta, but they keep running out every time I go. But it's definitely a must do. If you're in the Mills downtown area, check out Credo. Credo is a little coffee tea shop that you pay by donations only. Kind of weird, I know. But when I ordered my coffee and I went to go pay, they say, just pay what you think it's worth.
Wow.
Most likely people will end up paying more than what it's actually worth. Instead of $3, they'll pay $5 or $6, so they actually end up making money. It's genius the way they do things. One app that I love to go to, and it's not necessarily app, it's a website, it's Groupon. You guys have all heard of Groupon, right? If you haven't, it's a website or it's an app where you can find local deals. They have 40, 50, 60, up to 70% off deals from cosmetics to events. I have found the most amazing gems in Orlando through Groupon.com. I have gone skydiving. I have gone, the most recent one, I went flying trapeze. I've gone horseback riding. I took up archery through Groupon just to try it out. It was fun, and I actually ended up taking it on as a hobby. Another great thing to do if you're local and you're trying to find something to do, check out Groupon.com. Now, those are the pros. The cons about Orlando, and I'm sure most of you can agree, is the traffic.
Amen.
Who here agrees with me? Can I get a witness?
Amen.
The traffic here is just outrageous. It's something I've been living here for 10 years, and I still cannot get used to it. The drivers are crazy. Turn signals don't exist. Everything is so spread apart from one another. I feel like I live in my car more than I do in my own house, which is one of the reasons why I decided to move to a suburb of Orlando, which is much closer to work. I used to make 45 minutes to an hour commute from the UCF area to where I work at Scholastic Book Fairs for 2 years. It was taking a toll on my wallet, it was taking a toll on my car, and it was taking a toll on my sanity. I couldn't do it anymore, so I went ahead and I moved closer to work. And it's probably the best decision I could have made. Everything is still driving distance, and everything is still accessible to me. Three things that I would suggest everyone do while they're here in Orlando, if you're local in Orlando. Check out Park Avenue if you haven't checked it out. Everything is always driving distance. If you want to go to downtown Orlando, or you want to go to the beach, if you want to go to Tampa, if you want to go to Miami, go, because it is driving distance. We are in the center of the state. Check it out. I went to Savannah, Georgia. It was only 4 hours away. Very easy. I strongly encourage everyone to check out more of the local scenes, discover more, and it'll be something that you won't regret. Thank you.
I have 1 minute on the clock for evaluation. Time as a family reading together. Actually, I talk to my kids about finances, which Sam is about to go into, and hopefully we'll get some tips. And we also swim together as a family. Though Samuel has completed this lesson previously, he wanted to create another speech on the same lesson to better enhance his learning experience as a Toastmaster. In today's speech, he will be covering the basics of stocks, IRAs, and bond-based books, internet sources, and mentors. Because Samuel knows that many of you are already immersed in multiple forms of investing, he would like to request that you leave any tips of knowledge for him that you may have learned on your personal experience at the bottom of his evaluation sheets. Without further ado, please welcome Samuel with Stock Up on Information.
So when Julia asked asked me last week if I was ready for this speech, I should have told her no. Because as I continued researching this topic, I found more and more encouraging and in-depth information about investing and the opportunities that we have that many other countries don't to help enhance our pocketbooks. And today I would like to talk to you about three different kinds of investing: bonds, stocks, and IRAs. The first one I would like to talk to you about is bonds. And as defined off of Investopedia, a bond is a debt investment in which loans money to an entity, typically a corporation or governmental, which borrows the funds for a defined period of time at a variable or fixed interest rate. So with this, what you do is you take, let's say, $1,000. You put it into a bond. You can get a bond through either Scottrade, Edward Jones, Merrill Edge, banks, companies, mutual funds, a bunch of different ways you can do it. And then it gets an interest rate. And what the interest rate does is they pay you X amount of dollars, let's say 2%, to steadily grow your funds. If you're scared of investing, this would be a good starter. There's not really much capital gain on it, but it's a nice good way to kind of get your feet a little wet in there and see if you like it. The next one I would like to talk to you about is stocks. I have a little bit of experience with stocks, particularly with Rite Aid, RAD, and I would like to talk to you about that one. It's one that I've well known. And before you get invested into any stocks, you should spend about 6 months researching it. And when I say researching, I mean daily looking at it. Because what happens is stocks fluctuate. They may go up sometimes, they may go down, or at other times they'll just go ahead and strike a flop like in 2008. But what the 6 month time period does, it lets you learn the nature of whatever you're going to invest in. That's why you have some investors who strictly invest in Apple. It is what they know. And you should go into this comfortably, such as a poker player. It's why you see the same people in the national tournaments every single year. Though it may be viewed as a gamble, there is a system to the madness and a public perception that can help you learn whether or not that stock is a good buy. And I would like to evaluate my stock, Rite Aid, with you. There's a couple of different things that you can look at to kind of get a feel for it. The first thing you should look at is the actual price. Rite Aid currently, as of yesterday, was sitting at $8.59. Once it hits 10 o'clock, it'll change again. That's kind of a good indication of, is it going up or is it going down? Just have a little bit of value to it. You may have things such as penny stocks, which are very low in income, as it will state in this book I have been reading. Getting Started in Stocks, very educational and definitely a good read. Others, such as this one, have a little more value, or some will be $100,000, such as Warner Busters. But you can also see the target year estimate. So for Rite Aid, even though it's at $8.59 right now, is expected to grow to $10. So that is a stock that is expected to give you a little bit of capital gain. The next thing you want to look at is the beta. What the beta does is it tells you how much does it fluctuate? Is it volatile? Is it going to move? And what the benefits of that is, if you have a stock that's just going straight up like this, there's no point to it. You may think, but that's going up. No, no, no. You want something that's going to fluctuate a little bit. Because what that'll do is you want a stock that'll go kind of up and then down again. Because then let's say it was at 7 something at one point. Starts down at 5, moves up to 6. 5 to 6 is a profit. Goes back down again, let's say to 550. You don't have to worry about going down again because it's still a little bit of profit, but you can wait for it to go back up again to 650 and it continues to grow. But each time you have that little gap, you can make money from 550 to 650. It could even be 620 to 630, depending on the volume of what you buy. The next thing you want to look at is the day's range. That would kind of tell you, okay, is it fluctuating a little bit or is it just kind of sitting there? Is there enough people looking at it for you to look at it? As well as the 52 weeks range. That will give you a much better idea of the growth. For Rite Aid, in the last 52 weeks, it went from 448 to 907. So it is plenty of room for growth for you in there. The last thing you want to look at is the dividend and yield. What this is, it's kind of the company saying, hey, we got money, have some. They pay you to own their stock. It's kind of a little incentive for you to have it. The next thing I would like for everyone to take into consideration would be IRAs. IRA is Dave Ramsey's choice. Has everyone heard of Dave Ramsey before? Dave Ramsey, okay, I got one from the tube. Okay, there we go. What he does is he teaches a class called Financial Peace University. I went through it recently. And it has helped me double my car payments, eliminate all debt, as well as build savings accounts. Definitely a class I would recommend. But what he also does is he focuses on investing that helps you with your own personal growth as well as your personal income. So for stocks, you need money to gain money. But with these types of investments, it is very steady. The way that he explained it is, let's say you have someone who's about 20 years old. If they put $200 a month in for the next 10 years, that'd be about, what, $24,000 or so in there? Somewhere within that range. But by letting it sit and letting the interest, if you're a credit card company, that can be anywhere from 18% to 20%. I would like to think I could get that, but you know, we can play their tactics against them on a lower range. And it builds up. Within that next 30 years, if I start investing today and let it sit there, it can go up to hundreds of thousands of dollars. Let me give you an example. One of his buddies, of Dave Ramsey's, he went and bought himself a BMW, or he was going to at least. He had made a goal of once he reaches X amount of dollars, he was going to buy himself a $40,000 BMW. Quite an accomplishment. He got there to the dealership. The guy was ecstatic. Man, this is going to be an easy sale. He lets him take the car home. He shows his wife, shows his neighbors, and something just doesn't sit right in his stomach. It kind of turns a little bit. He said, I can't do it. It's too much money. So he goes back to the dealership and buys a $6,000 car instead. It takes the other $34,000 and puts it in a Roth IRA. Today, the $34,000 he put in there, without touching it, $300,000. He ran into a guy who later had the same car. It was worth $4,000. He not only saved himself $30,000, but he quadrupled it by 10. It was amazing. Now, maybe you're a little scared of stocks. I know I am young, and I know that I do not have as much experience as you. And I can see Stephen writing down plenty of notes for things I have messed up already. But I am learning, and I am encouraging you to learn. Many of you, actually, Stephanie made a comment to me, how did you get such a nice car? When I first looked into Rite Aid, it was at $1.17. I ended up selling it at $7.59, and that gave me the funds to be able to go out and buy my car. If you're willing to take the time, look into the types of bonds that you will be buying. Looking into the Roth versus regular IRAs, one of them's tax-free, one of them has a little bit deductible on it, depending on your needs. Or figuring out stocks that suit you. You can earn amazing amounts of money. And if you're not going to learn it for you and put your money in, imagine what kind of knowledge you can impart it to your children. Thank you.
We have 1 minute for evaluation. Thank you. I would encourage everybody to invest in IRAs and max out their 401k as much as possible. That'll ensure that you can continue to come to Toastmasters in retirement. I would like to say that we spend time reading poetry as a family, But that may be a next year. Alexandra is presenting this morning project number 2 from the Interpretive Reading Manual, Interpreting Poetry. The purpose of interpretive poetry is to convey through the voice, the mood, the meaning, and emotions of the poem. It requires the use of vocal techniques that will aid in the effectiveness of reading. Alexandra will be reading the poem, The Road Not Taken, by Robert Frost, first published in 1916. The Road Not Taken describes how a road chosen by a traveler had an impact in his life. Through his poem, Robert Frost has shown that the decisions we make should be carefully chosen, because not only will it affect our choices in the future, but there is no going back. The Road Not Taken is one of Alexandra's favorite poems of all times because it emphasizes the importance of decisions that could unlock new paths and how some opportunities will be eternally closed. Please join me in welcoming Advanced Communicator Bronze, Alexandra Baldwin.
Thank you for the applauses and encouragement. The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and sorry, I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaf no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads onto way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sight somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverge in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that had made all the difference. Mr. Toastmaster.
Evaluation.
amended.
I actually, combining the two, as far as investing, I like the, I actually have that poem printed, or at least that line, you know, two roads diverge in the woods, you take the one less traveled. And as far as investing, typically the crowd is not where you want to be. You want to be away from the crowd. That's where most likely you're going to make your money. Now we'll move into the more, exciting, but they're all exciting. Entertaining, let's say entertaining. Oh, that's all entertaining too. So the dreaded section of the meeting.
Thank you for that lackluster round of applause. The only thing I like about being table topics master is I know I won't be called on. But if you pay attention, I encourage you to answer these with gusto and feeling. There was once a saying, you can choose your friends, but your family? Gus, how should that be ended, and why?
Choose your friends and not your family. Indeed, I am very encouraged by the family members I have. They encourage me, especially when it's coming to the month of August the 6th. I get a lot of encouragement from them because I chose them. They will chose my birthday gift for the 6th. I hope you all got the announcement there.
One of the family times that I like the best is having dinner with my family. Tell us about your favorite family time dinner, Rich.
My favorite time I've ever had with my family is recently. I just bought a house over in Lake Mary. I'd also like to announce that my birthday is next Tuesday. Probably my future dinner will be next Tuesday with my family because they'll be bringing me presents. Anyway, the last time we had a nice barbecue at my new house. Last 2 years my parents passed away, so we did this dinner in an honor of my parents. So we played Jenga and we had a big cookout. We drank beers that my dad used to and cooked out. So that's my favorite family time I've had recently with my sister and her kids.
There's a few things that don't mix: politics, religion, and money.
You think it's funny.
Julia, how is money allocated in your household for family time and pleasure?
But it works for us. My husband and I are totally opposite. He is a business analyst and he thinks very logical. I am more of the laid back, common sense. So you try to pull those two in a household to do finances and it's like this. So we decided to keep our marriage strong to figure out how to do our finances in the same way that we can talk about it yet still understand it in our own ways. So we do it together. Every month I have a financial sheet that I go through our inflow and outflow, and he analyzes it, and he does this and I do that, and it works quite well. I appreciate Sam's speech today about investments, and something I will never fully understand. All I know is I need a good investor. So that would be my advice for anyone that is not into the stocks or bonds. Start early, invest, and have a financial advisor. Thank you.
Do we have time for one more?
Yeah. No.
No? Yes?
Okay, this one will go fast, I know. Traveling in your car on your vacation, your most memorable time, Stephanie.
Traveling in my car on my vacation. If I had a memorable time, I was probably alone because I don't like anyone in the car with me. One of those control freaks. But I can tell you, one time my mother insisted upon inviting her sister along, and we were going from New York to Georgia, and this sister is kind of difficult, to put it nicely. And we got into it on the road. They made me get a speeding ticket. I said, I'm sick of you bags. And of course, I got pulled over in South Carolina. I said, don't either of you say a word, I'm sick of you. I drove to the next motel. I got out, I said, get your room. I told the man, put me as far away from those biddies as possible. And the next day we drove straight to New York, and that aunt didn't speak to me for 12 fabulous years. I encourage you never to drive the business.
Mr. Toastmaster.
Move on to the educational portion of the meeting. We'll hand it over to Stephen Morgan, Master Evaluator.
And now time to get the feedback we desire. This is to expand and learn to grow and the encouragement to return and do it again. Beginning first with the prepared evaluations of the prepared speeches. As she makes her way around the room to get to the front, please welcome Carrie Bird, evaluating Monday.
Thank you, Carrie.
Thank you.
Hello, Toastmasters, guests, and especially Macarena. This was your vocal variety speech, and I liked it. I thought you used your vocal variety well. However, mostly at the beginning and the end, when you right in the middle, when you're actually talking about the things to do, it wasn't as much and as noticeable as the very beginning when you're asking how many people lived and grew up in Orlando, or the end when you were recapping. The other thing too is the lectern. You didn't need it, and it seemed to get in your way. You were here, and you were up here, and then you were like, oh, it's there, let me go over here. You know, your use of the room was good, but it seemed like you couldn't just move straight across, back and forth. I also thought you had very good eye contact. Watch some of your word choices. You used the word tons about 6 or 7 times. There's tons to do here, and there's tons to do there, and there's tons of things to do here. It was just encourage you to use a different word with that. But I really liked this speech. I loved your topic and thought it very appropriate. And I can't wait to hear the next speech.
Evaluating Samuel's speech. She can't squeeze around the ridge.
So strong, and you know, my goodness.
Please welcome Erica Benfield.
The project type was research your topic. Fellow Toastmasters, and especially Samuel. Taking a pause because I want to make sure that you understand how proud I am of you. You inspire me because I did not join Toastmasters until later in life. However, I'm going to make sure that you're even more successful than I am, so I'm going to give you some advice today.
That's that.
I And this is why you have to listen to me.
Okay.
Because it's research your topic. You give your topic, and then you have facts to justify why we should listen to you. The reason you should listen to me is because I was a judge for debate competitions in Seminole County. And that is what debaters do. They present their point of view, and they have to have facts to support it. And today, you did not have enough facts. On research your topic, you gave Dave Ramsey, who is a person, but not a factual person. It's an opinion of a point of view. And you gave us a book, which was here, called Getting Started in Stocks. The most important part when you give a book is the author and why this book should be viewed as important. That was missing today. Now, for a layman to stocks like myself, I have an accountant that I have on payroll that I pay every month, and he tells me how much to put in an IRA, and I just do what he tells me. So half of what you said went right over my head. Reason being is you use the word, and I hope Jorge doesn't pierce me with firing eyes, but I don't know if you said Rite Aid or RAD. I have no idea what that was. And something I learned when I had to be encouraged to speak on television was in pitching to the media, you want to stay away from jargon terminology. You want to either explain it clearly and then give what that word means versus just saying that word, assuming that we all knew what it was. So for me, I didn't get the speech. And you had tons of information. The title was Stock Up on Information, but it's for you to stock up on information. The information was for us to receive. And I just got little tidbits here and there. So I think the key here was when you gave that personal experience of how you got your car, I encourage you to use what terminology got you that car and maybe just share that portion of the story, because I think you're brilliant and I know you're very smart and you use stocks to your advantage. And that's something that we can all learn from. I felt like you had really good eye contact. You used fantastic hand gestures and you referenced a question to the audience, and that got us all engaged. I look forward to your next speech, and I hope I wasn't too harsh on you.
And evaluating Alexandra's poem, please welcome Jorge as he makes his way around.
General Evaluator, fellow Toastmasters, and Alexandra. I always feel like these speeches are the hardest to evaluate because you don't have all the typical walking around the room, making eye contact. It is strictly just reading, so it is more focusing just on the voice and the delivery of the speech or the poem itself, really. So I'm just going to read off of a couple of requirements that you had written here. One of them was, don't look at the audience, and I think you did a very good job of not looking at the audience. You did a little bit here and there, but it wasn't distracting. The book said that to not look at the audience because it really lets the poem sink in. And I think you did a good job of letting that poem sink in and not distracting us with eye contact. So you followed there. It says speak slower. I think in this instance, it was a little bit too slow. I know that what you want to try to avoid is the sing-songy cadence that a lot of people fall into when doing a poem, but you do want to at least convey a little bit of the rhythm. It should flow a little bit. It should have a little bit of a beat to it. But I think it was just a little bit too slow to where we couldn't get caught up in that actual rhythm of the poem, but not fast enough where it becomes like a song. I think it's hard to get that right rhythm and cadence down. So I just think it was a little bit too slow for this specific poem here. And then using voice to convey the mood, I think you did a good job of conveying that voice. It was a very serious, even tone. It is a very serious, thought-provoking poem. So I think that the tone that you took for the poem with your voice was very appropriate for this specific piece. For that, I think you did a great job, and I look forward to more of these interpretive readings.
I'd like to get the responses from our technical table, beginning first with our timer. How well did our speakers do today?
time allowed was 7 minutes, and she did 7:58. So she exceeded about 45 seconds. Sam Bailey, 8 minutes allowed. You did 8:15, so you were within the allowed time. Alexandra, you requested 1 to 3 minutes. You did 2 minutes and 16 seconds. That's within the allowed time. Table topics, Gus, 27 seconds. That was fast. Rich, 46 seconds. Julia, 1 minute 14 seconds. And Stephanie, 55 seconds. Evaluator number one, Kara Bird, you did, where's Kara? 1 minute and 29 seconds. Erica, 3 minutes and 23 seconds. And Jorge, 1 minute and 38 seconds. Mr. General Valerie, that's my report.
Our odd counter, Julia.
Thank you. That's a light group. I think that's a great thing. We had Paul, I only heard one and one double clutch. Carrie, one and two double clutches. Matt, one one but, and lots of tons. Sam, one one and a double clutch. Alexander, you're clean. Gus, one double clutch. Rich, I heard two ahs and three double clutches. Stephanie, one and two double clutches. Stephen, clean. Erica, clean. Jorge, one and three double clutches. And that is my report.
Andy is our grammarian. What did you happen to hear from us? Well,
this is very encouraging to realize that I'm in a fairly grammatical club. Now, there were a few little slight exceptions. Gus, I believe I heard you say something like, they will choose. And you should say, they will choose. And Julie, when you were talking about your husband, you said he thinks very logical. He thinks very logically. You need the adverb form of the word, not an adjective. And Macarena, yes, you did use the word tons as a slang word upon several occasions. When you're speaking informally, you can go ahead and do stuff like that, but you don't want to overdo it, just as your evaluator had mentioned. And Sam, when you were talking about the growth of an investment, you said it quadrupled by 10.
Yeah, I threw it out.
You could say that it multiplied by 10. Now, the greatest thing that I noticed here was a tremendous challenge that Alexandra did. Now, I know what it's like to do what she's doing because I did it. In my case, my old country was the United States, and I was living in Quebec where I had to speak poetry like that in the French language. And so her challenge is something that I'm very familiar with. I, for the last 25 years or so, one of my income streams has been teaching English as a foreign language to people from Hispanic and French-speaking backgrounds, and I have a few Germans in there. Right? Now, sometimes, and you see, your language, your native language, Spanish, does not equip you to properly pronounce certain sounds that are in English. When you, one thing that you said that you used the word applauses. Now that S in applause has a hard sound. It should sound more like a Z, applauses. And also, you forgot to pronounce the final D at the end of a simple past. Like two roads diverge, there needed to be a D sound. They diverged. And this kind of a combination never appears in the Spanish language. And also the short I sound, which sounds like I. If your first language is either French, Spanish, or Italian, and you have a word that has the short I sound, it sounds like if. You sometimes say if. And so, but What you were trying to do is something that is very difficult, and I can only congratulate you.
For a general evaluation of the meeting, things have been going smoothly. Paul was going through to make sure every role was filled as we needed. We had a nice little shuffling of the evaluators as we were going back and forth and ended up back where we started. The meeting starts at 7:30, you two, so that you are aware. Table topics, Eugene stepping up, thank you, and giving us a good set there, including specifically targeting those who didn't have other roles. All of that done well. I am supposed to comment specifically on the evaluations, as a general evaluator, evaluators do need feedback. And what I can suggest here, very different from what I'm used to hearing. Carrie and Erica, you were heavy on the suggestions there for what I felt like. Felt like tons, if you wish. Because Macarena was getting tons about tons here. It's like, oh my. There was a lot more room left there for more encouragement, and I'd suggest to do so because we want them to get back up and speak again. Macarena, loved the energy and the big smile that you were doing the whole time. It was great to see. Samuel had plenty of enthusiasm through all of his. For Jorge, you went the other route of going through the questions, fine. You had a very short amount to work with because she made her speech so short as it was. Although, to remind everyone, the sandwich, you want good encouragement at the front, you want very strong encouragement to finish with, so that the stuff in between can be a lot easier to eat. Therefore, I shall let our president come forward.
Well, she chews on that thought.
Business to talk about, but first the favorite part is I have some awards to present, and this first award is probably one of the toughest ones to earn in a year. It's called the Triple Crown, and what the Triple Crown is, it means that you've earned 3 educational awards in 1 year. That's a tall feat. It means you've had to have completed your Competent Communications Manual, a Competent Leader Manual perhaps, and an advanced manual, which is 10 speeches, and then your competent leadership manual. We have 2 people in this room that did this past fiscal year for our Toastmasters. I'd like to call up and congratulate Alexandra Balda. Toastmaster has earned, actually I think she put this program together, it's called the League of Volunteers. It's a beautiful pin that throughout the year you have to participate in all types of voluntary services. I said that wrong. Thank God the report's over. And I'd like to congratulate, I'm going to have her come up because she's got a sore back. Please give Stephanie Bodyburn. Seminar. Stephen was there as well, and there was a great amount of information that was provided. And the focus again is how do we grow our club. So keep thinking about as members what this club means to you, how we can be a stronger club, and any suggestions that you have, please feel free to email myself, any of the other officers. How do we improve as a club, and how do we meet your needs as members? So keep that in mind and keep the feedback coming. We have some dates to talk about, and I will ask Gus to talk about our upcoming first contest of the year.
And that will be the humorous speech and evaluation contest we'll be having. You need that to complete project 6 and 8 in this. Let me encourage you to attempt to do it. You will have all the support you need. The most outstanding Toastmaster will be able to guide you. So do I hear anyone who wants to compete in your SEER project 6 or 8, please talk to
me. Get it right. It's not, you don't get it for competing. You're talking about someone coordinating.
Yeah, coordinating. Thank you very much. That's why Stephen is always coaching me. We want someone to be the chair of the contest, and then you will select the different team members, but that will help you to complete this. So if you want to do that project and chair the contest, you have all the support and encouragement that is needed. So let me know as soon as possible. Thank you.
And the date is September 1st.
September 1st, and the meeting starts at a different time. We start at
7 a.m.
So those who will be competing need to be here at 6:30.
All participants. All
right. So whether you want to participate at a ballot counter, actually not so much a judge. We're trying to cross over and have judges from other clubs judge our contest, and we as well judge others. That will help you earn that ambassador pin that you can. So upcoming dates for other clubs for their contest, keep in mind if you can volunteer for theirs. We have Seminole Toasters, which is a Friday. They meet at lunchtime hours, 11:15 on August 11. The 14th, right? Articulators meets on a Thursday, August 27th for their contest, and that's a 7:15 a.m. club. And then Seminole State College Toastmasters is having their contest a little later, September 15th. So keep that in mind if you'd like to participate, and as well as we'll be asking other clubs to judge for ours. Any questions on the contest? All right. We have officers' makeup training that I'll be reaching out to whatever officers haven't been trained in August. And I'd like to hear from our guests, starting with Andy Murphy. You are a Seminole Toaster. Tell us what you thought of our meeting.
Well, it's interesting that what I thought about the meeting just got put down on my ambassador form here. I really enjoyed it. This is a club where the first thing that impressed me right off the bat is your very efficient use of time. You could go right from one thing into another. Things happen on time, and you don't have things happening a little later and later and later, as we sometimes have at our club. But I enjoyed this. I enjoyed everybody. You have quite a variety of people from different backgrounds, and this is really interesting.
And we're glad
so,
you
enjoyed
our meeting.
Well,
you can come
I,
back anytime.
I'll be happy to. I really enjoyed this one. Thanks.
Awesome. We are efficient and time sensitive because we're a morning club. And I want to hear from Richard. You're kind of like an ambassador. You got to stand up and you got to tell us what you thought.
I think you're all going to go to the members' house.
I think yes. You're
still a guest.
Yeah, can you join?
I have that said honorary Toastmaster on it, so I now feel like I am a guest. That is actually very insulting to me.
Julia, next week.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, please.
Okay, so next lineup. Oh,
34.
We have.
Yes. Yeah, go, keep going.
Okay. We have a guest speaker next, so invite any members that you haven't seen, get them back here, invite guests. We have the international contest winner of District 84 going to be here presenting. We want to encourage him because he's going on to Las Vegas, and he's here specifically to get your feedback. How did he do? What can he do better to win the contest? So please show up next week ready to give him some information about how he can win the international speech contest. For the rest of the schedule, we have, I'm Toastmaster. We have Mark, that's going, we have Ernst speaking, ready? We have Stephanie speaking. We have Alexandra, Eugene, you're not gonna be here next week. Probably or definitely?
Definitely.
Okay. I don't mean it that way.
Toastmasters.
I encourage you to find someone else.
I need a general evaluator. Any takers? Erica?
I have to say, that was a lot.
Okay.
So I'd rather not be on there until
okay.
I know for sure.
Jorge?
Take the train.
Probably.
I
can do it.
It doesn't drop me off here.
All right, Jorge, I need a general evaluator.
Carrie,
evaluator.
Yeah.
We need a second evaluator. Any takers? Going once.
No. All right. Am I on the
list
already?
Hmm?
I'm in the list already.
Sam, you're an out-counter?
Okay, yes.
Mac, you're a Marion?
Welcome.
Yes? Okay. And Rich Tyro?
I actually crossed my next week is my birthday, so I don't think
I'm I don't want to make any promises.
You don't want to see me 7:30 on my birthday.
And your birthday soon?
Yeah. I might be in that at that time.
We'll fix that throughout the week. Anyways, I shall call this meeting adjourned. Great meeting, everybody.
Yeah.